marks the 15th anniversary of the 9/11 attacks. And start out with reading some writing the words of St. Francis of Assisi. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to counsel, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. It is in dying that we are born again to eternal life. Most of us still remember where we were when we first heard on radio or saw on television reports of the attack. On that morning, my wife Gail and I were getting ready to leave for work at our gallery. As I walked by the television, I saw the report of the first plane hitting the tower. Stopping to watch, we, like everyone else in the nation and much of the world, were left wondering just what had happened. I doubt many of us were thinking terrorism at that moment. But then the second plane appeared, and we all saw it hit the other tower on live television. And I believe we nearly all thought, or even some cried out, terrorism, terrorists. A major terrorist attack on U.S. soil that had never happened before. At that moment, our safe home, world rather, here at home, was forever shattered. No longer were terrorist attacks something that happened overseas. Now they could and had happened here in the U.S. Suddenly, our world had changed. For those of us who remember it, it was a powerful moment. Let us pause for a few moments to remember our emotions, our thoughts, and our fears at that very time. It's now 15 years later, and to put that into some perspective, the young people who started their first year of high school this year were not even born yet. The world seemed to change in the flash of an eye for us older folks, but for the very young then and those who have been born since, the world is as they have always known it to be, and that in and of its own is horribly sad. I'd love to be able to say that the world is less dangerous today, or even only as dangerous as it was on that awful day. But the sad truth is it is even more dangerous. And I don't see the world's leaders doing what needs to be done, or even having the conversations that need to be had to make the world safer. Though for a short time after 9/11, the powers that be here in the U.S. seemed to put their differences aside, it did not last long. Not long at all. Political correctness, along with individual and party political and financial gain, have once again taken the main stage. Sad to say, it's become another can that we are kicking down the road and dooming our children and grandchildren to have to come to task with someday in the looming future. I'm certain that by now you've all noticed those pieces of paper taped to the ends of the pews. These pages with names listed upon them. Well, of course, those are the nearly 3,000 names of the individuals who died on 9/11. The names that are not included are the names of the unborn children who died that day in the womb. 11 that are known for certain, but only our God knows for sure how many. Nor are there included the names of those who have died from health complications, from the toxins that they were exposed to, from helping with the rescue and cleanup, or from just being unlucky enough to have been in the area and being covered with debris and breathing the dust and the fumes on that fate-filled day. The list also excludes all those who were injured, both physically and emotionally, and the terrible toll that those wounds have had and are still having on their lives, even 15 years past. In preparation for this sermon, I reread some of the news reports and watched several old videos. Perhaps nothing portrays and solidifies the horror of that day like the images of those that jumped from the buildings to their deaths, rather than facing death and the fires that raged around them. The image of one couple who held hands as they jumped seems to have burned itself into the minds of many of those who witnessed this horrific event. As we relive those moments, these emotions and fears, the same question that haunted the nation that day returns to the front of our collective mind. Why, God? Why and how could this have happened? And where was God during all this death and wanton destruction? Why and where, God? I've addressed this question here in this sanctuary before, during the funeral for Jeff Gordon, to be precise. A portion of what I'm about to relay to you comes from a message that I gave on that day. It's a message that we all need to keep in our mind as the world seems to be becoming constantly crazier and crazier, like a crazier and crazier place to live as our lives go on. Far, far greater minds than I have attempted to tackle this ever-present and monumental question, this question of why God. I approach this topic with no small amount of humility and a complete understanding of my insignificance and attempted to lend my voice among those who are or were giants among theologians. But I come to this question of why with my many years of studying, not only Scripture, but studying about Scripture. With my many years of individual study with my late mentor, the Reverend Dr. Jesse Brown, whose vast credentials I have relayed before and I will admit today, I add to this my own life experience within my 56 years on this earth and a relationship with my Lord that has been extremely contentious, a relationship where I have never shied away from asking why and even for many years being angry with and denying. Through all of this, I have arrived at a relationship with my God where I am at peace with his being and perhaps more importantly, at peace with my own being and my place in his kingdom. So much at peace with God that I felt his calling to come here and be with all of you. Why, God? Why do the innocent and the very young have to perish? Why did all those people 15 years ago have to perish just for deciding to take the wrong airline flight, or having taken jobs or other obligations in the affected buildings and areas? But the whys don't stop there. What about all those who have suffered health problems and death from the toxins they were exposed to as they rushed in to assist in the rescue and cleanup? Why did they suffer for doing good, for showing compassion and kindness their fellow man, or for having just decided to visit the area on that particular day? Why? The whys are simply never end. Often when confronted with this difficult and frankly extremely uncomfortable question, we ministers, as well as nearly all lay people, will just say something along the lines of, "We don't understand God's ways, or worse yet, it's all part of God's plan." I'll be honest with you, I cringe when I hear these things. It doesn't paint a very pretty picture of the God that I love with all of my being. We don't understand God's ways. This I agree with, but not in the fashion that most make this statement are implying. We don't understand God because he is God. And he, as God, sees the big picture, the whole picture. And we're here living in a snapshot of our life at any given moment. As we grow older, we hopefully gain understanding of the snapshots that have gone on before, and we can apply that acquired knowledge to the moments to be photographed still. Man. But nonetheless, we live in a very finite time frame in this world. God, of course, is infinite. His being and understanding is obviously different than our own. Let me try to share with you a little insight that I have gained from the snapshots of my life thus far. We don't understand God's ways partly because God is entirely a being of love, grace, and forgiveness. As in perfect, egotistical, envious, and often angry humans have difficulty grasping, even for a moment, the depth of the love that God has for his children and his creation. God loves each of us so very much that all that he desires is a relationship of mutual love with each of us. But he does not and will not force us to come to him and love him. Rather, his desire is that we of our own free will come to love him. God is always in pursuit of us. Trust me. He chased me and he chased me. I tried my best not to love him, but ultimately I found that I could not resist. We are all granted this free will, this liberating yet terrifying freedom, which theologians have discussed for many, many centuries. God gave us each free will to decide for ourselves if we wish to love God, if we wish to have a relationship with him. This free will, though, had to, by its virtue of its fully being free will, it had to spill out into every aspect of our lives. We, as autonomous beings and not biological robots, can and do make hundreds or thousands of decisions each and every day. Unfortunately, along with any good decisions, we make are far too many rash and or poor decisions. Thus, we arrive upon days like the one 15 years ago today. Because God has allowed us the ability of free will, we can decide to worship him, or we can decide to worship some other god, or to worship no god at all. We can decide to cause good, or we can decide to cause harm, and be the bondservant of evil in this world. I would present to you that those who conducted the attacks of 9/11 were indeed the bondservants of evil. Thousands of innocent people lost their lives because less than 24 people exercised their free will and chose to do evil. This wasn't done under the direction of God. It was done because of human ego and very bad decisions. Those people did not die because God wished for them to die. God cried that day. He cries each day and every hour when one of his children decides to side with evil and walk away from God's love and grace. In both the Gospel of Luke and Matthew, we read these words spoken by Jesus. Luke 13, verse 34. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often have I desired to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing. This verse and others speak to God's allowing us free will and to his dismay and disappointment when we fail to respond to his love held out for us. God wishes to cover us with his wings, just as it says here in Luke and Matthew, and as well as it says here in Psalm 91, verses 3 and 4. For he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you will find refuge. Unfortunately, as Luke and Matthew convey, we don't always respond to God's love. We all too often make bad decisions and walk away from God. Our need to come to God in love and our relationship out of our own free will is such an extremely important element of our salvation that God has allowed all of the other bad decisions that arise out of free will to enter into this world and into our existence. All the evil that is allowed to be manifested in the hearts of men are a result of the absolute need for us to individually make our commitment to our all-loving and all-gracious God. This is how important it is for us to love God of our own accord. Think about that, folks. This love for God is so vitally important. Through all of what life throws at us, because of our free will, and because of others' free will in turn, know that your God loves you, all of you. God does not cause tragedy to happen. But what he can do and what he will do if we are attentive is to show to us in those times of darkness and despair his love for us. Good can come out of tragedy, and even evil acts if we are determined to do good in the name of our God. Again, Romans 8, verses 28 through 39. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn within a large family. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own Son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Jesus Christ who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let us end the sermon by reading responsibly the insert that you see in the bulletin. On the morning of September 11th, 2001, 2,976 people from 93 nations lost their lives in New York at the Pentagon and on Flight 93. Today we pause to remember that moment of horror and pray for those left forever scarred by these terrible events. We remember the first time we heard the news. We recall the first time we saw those images. We remember the way our thoughts and prayers were with those families who lost loved ones. Our thoughts and prayers are with them again.
O God of comfort, though the years have passed, you are faithful still. Yesterday, today, and forever, let your love and peace endure.
We remember those who survived. We recall their heartbreaking stories. We remember that their lives are forever scarred by those moments. Our thoughts and prayers are with you again today.
O God of healing, though the years have passed, you are faithful still, yesterday, today, and forever. Let your love and peace endure.
We remember the pain we felt. We recall the bereavement and bitterness of the aftermath. We remember that you are a God of redemption and restoration. Help us forgive those who caused so much trauma, and that we may find release in that forgiveness.
O God of forgiveness, for the years have passed, you are faithful still. Yesterday, today, and forever, let your love and peace endure.
We remember that you loved the world. We recall you sent your Son to bring reconciliation and salvation. We remember your Spirit inhabits your church. Help us bring your comfort and peace to all.
God of hope, though the years have passed, you are faithful still. yesterday, today, and forever. Let your love and peace endure. Amen.
Come now, we're not sharing the Lord's.